This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Alex. And this is, of course, the ramble. And over there, let me see here. I have a way of doing this now. Let me see if I can do this right here. Let me see here. There. Well, there we go. We don't want that. We want to go back and forth like that. Okay. There she is, hey. Ladies and gentlemen. That is my wife.
The one and only.
The one and only wife. Yeah. So tell me, how's it going?
Fine.
You had the day off today?
I took the day off today. Had lunch with the girlfriend, and it was great.
Because it was her birthday, right?
Well, it was her birthday 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
This is the only time we were able to get together.
Well, that was nice.
Yeah.
You know. Let me mention something here. First off, I want you to look, if you're listening to the show on Facebook Live, which we do every night now, you're seeing me, and you also are seeing girlfriend over there. There she is. And right below this, I posted again, I'm not violating my thing about not posting stuff. I said I would post promotional stuff. And our good friend Bob Rubin, who does this program occasionally, has what do they call these things, crowdfunding source? Pay attention to me.
I'm looking.
No, don't look.
Fundraiser.
Yeah.
For a startup.
Yeah, and not for a startup.
But for anything.
In this case, he wants to do a show, a comedy show, and tape it, and then sell, you know, the broadcast rights to somebody like Netflix or whoever would want to buy it.
Yeah.
And
Starkick.
I don't know what this one is.
But it's like that.
Yeah, it's one of the crowdfunding things. So I put the thing up so people would be able to see it and perhaps give some bucks to him. You know, if every one of you who I know are watching this on Facebook were to give 10 bucks...
He could retire. Do you know how many millions of subscribers they have?
Yeah, well, all I'm saying is that we could... he could then probably fund this thing without any problem. Right now, it's going very slow for him. So I'm just asking if you can.
What are you doing? But
this is how I change cameras.
Oh, I didn't know.
Don't ask stuff like that.
Sorry.
I have new magic. I can change cameras with one finger stroke. Okay? So anyway. So what I'm doing is I'm asking you,
To donate.
To donate something. I'm going to throw in like 10 bucks or 20 bucks. But I thought I'd throw the weight of my program behind this.
Weight.
Yeah, great weight. You know, it's been weighing me down for years, folks. You know, I'm just hoping that you know, maybe we can get this. He wants to get 8,500 bucks, and he's up to, what does it say there? Does it say? No, you have to click on it to get to the site, and then it's. But he's only got something like $400 some odd or something.
$510.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We've actually had people respond to my
plea,
begging and pleading.
Yeah.
So hopefully, you know, hopefully.
I'll donate. I'll donate.
You'll donate. How much mm-hmm. are you going to donate?
I don't know.
You know, if you donate $8,500. He will let you be the executive producer of the whole damn thing.
You get a signed CD.
Yeah, but if I'm going to donate $8,500, I want a percentage of the take. Yeah, you know. So, but anyway, so I hope you will, just because Bob is a very funny comedian, a great guy, and you know, he's in a business that right now is not treating him that well. You know, and
is it because there's
turn that off? Get rid of that. Just get rid of it.
Is it because there's too many comedians? Or is just the business going flat?
Well, the business has gone flat. You know, in the old days in San Francisco, and it had a lot, I will say it had a lot to do with me. I used to pay comedians a really decent amount of money. And so they could then go somewhere else and say, well, Alex pays me so much. You're not going to pay me that, you know, and they go, okay. And so they were paying good money to the people, especially the San Francisco comics. Now they'll get away as cheap as they possibly can, you know. And the only money they'll give to people are people who have like a national name. And Bob, Bob has suffered, I guess, with a major problem. And that major problem is that has been, how can I put it? When people are really good and they're really special and people say, he's such a genius, they somehow believe, and they have a right to expect, that the world is going to come to them, you know, just jump into their laps because you're so talented.
Well, it's hard to sell yourself. It really is.
Well, that doesn't necessarily make it.
That's true.
You know, what does make it
is an agent.
Huh?
An agent.
Is an agent or a... you know, or just your own ability to promote yourself.
That's very difficult.
And
it's hard.
You know, years ago, I told Bob, you know, if you've listened to Bob, you know that he is from Kentucky or North? No, Kentucky, I think. I may be wrong, but he's from a real southern state. He's technically a hillbilly, okay? And he once used to say that, in fact, he was. Let me see here. He was a Jewish hillbilly, and he is Jewish, and he was born in that part of the country, and has the southern voice and everything like that. But his humor is not country. He's not, you know, Larry the Cable Guy or one of those kind of guys. He's very cerebral and very offbeat and weird. And years ago, he has a sister, and his sister was a PR person in Nashville. And I said, if I were you, I'd forget San Francisco.
And move to Nashville.
I would go to Nashville, and I would, you know, sell yourself as the cerebral country comic. I said, then, you know, Johnny Carson will have you on because you're different. You're not just the normal country comic, you're cerebral, you know, you're weird, you're different. And he didn't take my advice. And now he admits it was good advice, but he should have done it, because his sister could have then taken him around to places and promoted him.
Yeah.
Now she's not really in the business anymore, and you know.
Well, it's 27 years later.
Yeah, yeah. So, but to me, he's one of the funniest people I know. And he's a brilliant comic with brilliant, a brilliant mind that is now going to waste. And he told me something very sad on a show we did, I think it was either this week or last week. He said, and it was really pathetic, actually, that he things have not been going good. So he's been trying to get a straight job, you know, and everywhere he goes, he can't get that kind of job. Why? Because the last 20 years of his resume are doing nothing but comedy.
Oh.
And there's no, you know, nothing about him doing, you get what I'm saying?
Other skills that would be applicable to the.
So we said that 20 years in comedy ruined me for anything else.
Not really. I mean, you can take skills and write it up, because you do have certain skills doing that for 20 years.
Well, what kind of skills? I mean, if you're going to go to work at
good at traveling, good at staying at $5 night hotel rooms.
yeah, that's really qualifies you for Walmart.
Well, you can write. He can write copy, probably.
Who was it was telling me, and this was a really strange story, that they actually applied to Walmart, who sent him a notice that he wasn't going to be hired by them. He said to get a rejection letter from Walmart you know, is a bit over a bit much. So
it's funny
they were against that. But who told me that? Could it have been Bob? But anyway, I love Bob. Go to the right below here.
Go to his website.
It'll take you to the crowdfunding. Just $10, you know, $20 if you can afford it. 100 if you feel that you really love this guy and have known him over the years.
And 8,500 if you want to be the producer.
You get on the credits as executive producer, okay?
That's what guys did when they wanted to get laid. They put their girlfriends on.
Yeah. So anyway, I'm crowdfunding to get laid. Yeah, that's interesting. That would be interesting.
No, I'm executive producer.
Yeah.
So I
just finished. I finished watching all 13 episodes of Iron Fist.
What's that one about?
That was the one about the guy with the iron fist, the kung fu guy, the kid who comes home and he thought he was dead, and there he is at his company that he owns 51%.
Oh, right.
And I watched it, and I actually felt it was a good storyline. You know, really good storyline.
But I hear a but.
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 The lead actor sucks.
Yeah, the one that I saw, I didn't like.
The one person who it pivots on.
Was him.
Was him. And he's not that terribly good, you know? So, that's the big problem. I binge watched all 13 episodes. Why, I have no idea. As soon as we saw the reviews, and I think Rotten Tomatoes gave it a 19%.
Something like that. It's like immediately, like he turned off from it.
I said I was gonna stop. And then I decided, maybe I won't stop. Maybe it's just
Rotten Tomatoes.
and so I then got to two of them. And then I got to three of them. And finally, when you get to about five, you go, I'm almost halfway.
Yeah,
now.
You're in there.
You know, so then all of a sudden you're watching one after another after another. And it wasn't, as I say, it wasn't bad. The Marvel stuff, you won't watch it. But the Marvel stuff they're doing on Netflix is sensational because it's really adult stuff. It's not, you know, Caped Crusaders. Wait, give them that face again. What was the face of you? You know, no, I'm telling you. I mean, Jessica Jones, which you won't watch with David Tennant, is just wonderful. And the one that was done here in Harlem.
Why do you insist, and not only insist, but get angry at me if I do not watch the ones you want to watch?
Well, I mean, all I'm saying is...
There's some things that we both like to watch, and there's stuff that you like to watch and stuff that I like to watch.
But you missed Luke Cage.
So what?
Well, Luke Cage...
I did watch it.
Was done here in Harlem.
I did watch it. I watched two or three of them.
And it also starred the guy who won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor. He's in it, too, as the bad guy.
So what?
Whatever his name is. It's some name like Maya Angelou. I don't know what his name is. It's
he was a skinny, tall guy that was...
Yeah, he was a guy in the thing where the kid is... He's a pimp or a dealer or something, and the kid, he becomes a father figure to the kid at the beginning of it.
Oh, right.
Yeah, in the picture that won the Academy Award.
He was in two pictures this year. He was also in Hidden Figures.
And actually, he was better in that, I think. Than he was in I can't even remember the name of the picture now, and it won the Academy Award.
We both watched this picture, and I have to admit, after I do not remember watching. Remember, I kept saying I don't remember watching it. I do not remember a thing. I know the general outline of it, but I don't remember the picture.
Well,
I didn't fall asleep.
The problem is you're having motion picture Alzheimer's.
Probably.
You know, which is a terrible, terrible thing to have happen, and we'll have them check you out. No, but what was the name of the picture? It was
something about it's about the kid that was black here, and he was gay.
The picture is just
one best picture
2 weeks ago, and we've forgotten the name of it already.
And we saw it.
Yeah, and I'll bet you if I went to my audience and said. And just randomly ask people, what was the name of the movie? You probably don't remember it now.
Well, they do. We're just older.
Huh?
We're just older.
I guess.
Yes.
You know.
That's my excuse lately.
Yeah. Well, I just, you know. So what? You know? Really. What? Moonlight.
Moonlight.
Moonlight. That's the name of it.
It was
Moonlight.
Just one word, Moonlight?
Moonlight. Just one word. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't remember the picture. I mean, I know the general theme of it, but I don't remember.
Well, here's what they did. See, here's what they figured. Listen, we need more black people nominated. In fact, so many people got nominated who were black. There were like 7 awards given away to blacks this year, something like that. I didn't see any Asians. I didn't see any Hispanics. You know. By the way, what was it last year when The Revenant won? He was Spanish, or not Spanish, Mexican. So that
Leonardo?
No, the director.
Oh, right, director. Yes.
And the year before that, the winner of the best director was for a picture. He was black.
It was all black.
He did a picture called 10 Years a Slave.
Yeah, that was a great movie. And they won a lot of awards. Reason why there was so much backlash, but last year there just wasn't a good movie.
No.
There
wasn't a good movie.
I mean, it wasn't racially motivated. There just wasn't.
We're not going to vote for you. We'll vote for black people when the black person we're being asked to vote for is Tyler Perry in a dress. Okay? You know? So fuck you.
Can you put that on?
Oh, jeez.
Well, it's warm in here, Alex.
Yeah, well, but we're doing a show. You don't talk about that.
Well, I didn't. I just went like that.
No, you said, will you, blah, 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 blah. My wife, the mime. By the way, I'm not going to apartment house meetings anymore.
No.
I went to this meeting this week. They had one, and we go, well, okay, you know, it'll be the tenancy.
It's an update.
Huh?
It's an update.
It's an update, but also here's what you can do and here's what you can't do.
Well, she's not a leader.
Well,
she's
not a leader. And the person who's the head of it, I got into a little spat with her.
Yeah, and she should apologize to you. She was rude.
She was rude because she doesn't like to be questioned as to her authenticity of stuff. What she said was that, and this is something that probably doesn't even mean anything to people, but that some of the apartments, they are taking the gas meter and moving it lower, which is not aesthetically pleasing. Okay, ours is up in a cabinet. And the guy the other day told me, when he was here, he says, oh, by the way, you know, you're lucky, you get to keep yours up there.
Oh, we do?
Yeah. And he said, but a lot of people, we have to bring it down. And I said, why? And they said, because they don't want the meter reader to have to get on a ladder.
You know, that's bullshit. Then it's not required by law. They don't have to take it down.
Well, this woman said it was required by law. It wasn't required by law.
It's required by Con Ed.
By Con Edison. So anyway, and we're having trouble with our gas because they took it out of our dryer, which we then have to go get special stuff. But anyway, at this meeting, I just got so tired. I mean, and so bored with it. And so nothing was accomplished, okay?
Yeah, they're going to do the letter. That was accomplished.
What, the letter to who?
To the management, and it's going to be signed by everybody, and it's going to go out on Monday.
But we can't sign it.
No, we can't sign it. They know we can't sign it.
Yeah.
But the other people will sign it.
Yeah, and what will the ownership do? They won't do anything.
Who knows?
Right? You know, I mean, of course, you know, landlords in this town are notorious, aren't they?
Oh, they're horrible.
You had one over where you were.
Oh,
she has an apartment she owns now, but before she owned it, she rented it. And
we had to take them to court. The Tenants Association, which I sat on the board, we had to take them to court.
You had to take them to court for what?
Oh, just all kinds of abuses, just similar to this. Just things weren't being done and this and that.
And now that you're
An owner,
you don't have any real problems.
Well, they got, for the first 5 years, they had a majority on the board. Well, that 5 years has been over. So now it's just normal. They still get a couple of seats because the rentals are still owned by them, mm-hmm. You know, that haven't gone condo.
Yeah.
But they've done a whole new laundry room. They did a whole new lobby. I mean, they've done a lot of work on it. And It's a nice apartment. It really is. The building is nice. It's old. I've got great tenants. Love them.
Yeah.
You met
them. Yeah.
Very nice.
But all I'm saying is that I just got so fed up yesterday. I just said, that's it. You know, I don't, why do I need this? You know, And you know, it's like they don't get anything really accomplished. Like, they had us all refuse. Verizon is coming into our building, and they had us all refuse to sign up with Verizon.
So they could get a deal.
And they said, if we stick together, we can get a good deal out of Verizon. So we stuck together. And the deal they got from Verizon was, if you sign up online, you'll get 10% off, which when you get to that place on the Verizon site, it says, if you sign up here, you can get 10% off. And they thought, oh, we accomplished something. We got, and it was like on the first month or something.
Yeah.
You know? So I don't think that there's, to begin with, there weren't enough people there. You know, they got to go around, interest more people in meeting. Because if there were, like, you know, maybe there are, what do they say, 65 apartments in this building or something, or that have been affected at least by the gas outage. So that means there may be, let's say, 100. If we could get 50 people there, then you'd have some kind of powerful group.
I don't think there's 100, but there's enough.
Yeah. I mean, 90, let's say.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, so if you could get half of that, 45, 50,
and you've got a bargaining chip.
Then you've got a bunch of people that are able to wield their power, as it were. So anyway, I'm, you know, the apartment politics are, you know, and then the person who's like heading it up is like, it's like she's on stage and she can't just tell you, hey, here's what's happening, blah, 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 blah. No, she has to articulate it in broad terms.
Well, the woman that handled it for years before her did a great job. I mean, she got the garden together. They took them to court to get the buzzer put in. I mean, they didn't have a buzzer. People had either had to throw the keys out the window or come down and let people in.
Let me put it this way. All around our neighborhood, there is an upscaling of the neighborhood.
It's gentrifying.
Except for this apartment house.
No, that's not true. It is.
What do you mean? They put new numbers on the front of the buildings, you know, but the lobbies still look terrible. Yeah. They got all that cracked mosaic tile, you know. Yeah. Screw that, you know. So anyway.
Anyway, it's almost time.
It's almost time. Here's what we're going to do tonight once again. I'm going to put on a spot that's going to go for a little bit here. Let me see. Where is it? I want to make sure I have it. Okay. And we're going to let it go. And then I'm going to do a bunch of magic here. And you will see on the Facebook page a new, if you refresh it in about 2 minutes from right now, you'll see a new
thing
going. You'll still have the old one, just the audio.
But it'll be two separate things?
But two separate things. But the new one that I put up there will be the citizens panel.
And then at the end, you combine them, right?
Huh?
Then at the end, at 12 o'clock, you combine them.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I try. Maybe I'll do it tomorrow.
You've combined it because when I listen to it on Monday, it's combined.
Yeah, well, the audio will just be fine, but all you'll see is me. But if you want to see the citizen panel, go to this thing that's going to be above it, all right? And so I'm going to play a little bit of stuff here, and hopefully by then I will have it playing and all of that, and let's keep our fingers crossed. So thank you so much, girlfriend. You'll be back with us when we're, you know, ready to go here. So everybody, stay right where you are.
Stay near the telephone.
Yeah, you betcha. Anyway, hello everybody. How are you? I see if you're looking now, you can go up and watch the TV part. Let me just see if it's running up here. It gets very confusing to me. For an old guy like me, it's very confusing. Let me also put me on here. Let me see here. There we go. And
can I roll on over?
Yes, you can roll on over, dear. Let me see here. Have we got me on the picture? There we go. Okay, we're going. Hold on a second. Let me just get stuff done, okay?
Okay.
You know? Don't give me a bad time here. So now I've got to turn on Skype. All right. Now Skype is online, and you can call us at Skype if you want to. If you don't want to, that's okay, too. Anyway. Let me put this up here so I get out of the way of here, and I have these things going. Okay, we're ready to go if you want to call us. Let's hope that the Skype is working okay. It might not be. You know, there's always that possibility. Bob Eberth is calling, and so we will answer the call. Let me see here. Bob, are you there? There is Bob Eberth. Hello.
Hey, Bob.
Wait a minute. We don't hear you, Bob. We don't hear you.
I made it this time.
There you go. Yeah, you made it this time.
I like your microphone.
When you called back, it was on my cell phone. It came back.
Oh, really?
Well, yeah, it was weird.
Well, that's because you probably have yourself listed on a cell phone or something like that. But you could have answered the cell phone. Let me see. Scott Boddicker is calling, and we add Scott to the group. Hello, Scott. How are you this evening? Let me now give people a shot of what I'm seeing on Skype. There we go. Hold on a second. I got to transition to that. There we go. Now everybody can see who I'm talking to.
Where's Scott?
Scott, turn on your camera.
Just a second. Let me find it.
yeah, go find it. Here we go. Now we're about ready to see him. That's
there
fine. That's fine.
Hey,
that's
fix my hair first.
Yeah, fix your hair. That's what I do. I have to do mine too. See. Anyway, you were missing in action last night, Scott. Where were you?
Oh. You were having such a tough time getting people on, I decided to give you a break.
Well, last night I was trying something different. Okay, so tonight I'm not, and tonight it's just when people call, I just go add to the group, and we're fine, you know. So.
Yeah, that works a little slicker.
Here comes.
But it's not in HD or whatever.
It's pretty clean. It's pretty clean. It's just not widescreen is what doesn't happen here. So anyway. Hello, Dan. How are you this evening? We haven't heard from you in a while.
Dan.
It's been a while, but here I am.
Has Periscope seduced you?
No, I gave up on Periscope, and I did a little thing on Facebook Live yesterday.
Facebook Live is so much easier to use, and people actually watch Facebook Live.
Yeah, even when you're scrolling.
Right.
Huh? You're scrolling, you see it, you turn it on. You don't have to go anywhere.
Right.
Yeah, because everybody's on Facebook anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now they got a new thing. It's called Marco Polo. Have you heard of that one?
What do you do? Go to a swimming pool and watch it?
Marco Polo is like, it's kind of like Skype, but a walkie-talkie. It's like you can talk to friends individually via video. It's a thing. I just discovered it tonight. One of my friends.
It's on Facebook. Right.
What's it called? Walkie
Marco Polo.
Marco Polo.
Marco Polo.
Well, you know what happens is that I think, for instance, if people look at the video on what you're seeing on my Facebook page, when you're looking at the video of the citizen panel, is you're looking at YouTube. And YouTube's quality is just breathtaking.
Is it?
I mean, Facebook looks great, but it's breathtaking. Look at it. It's incredible.
Is that YouTube?
Yeah, that's YouTube.
Over there?
Yeah, what you're seeing on Facebook with the panel is YouTube. So, yeah. How you doing, Phil Meyer?
Hey, good evening.
Yeah.
What's up, Phil?
Yeah.
Hi, Dan.
Yeah.
Hey, everybody.
We're waiting for his camera to go on.
Oh, it's not on? Let me...
You got the tough guy motorcycle...
he looks really studly.
Hell's Angels.
Studly True Heart there.
There he is.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, I'm calling it an early evening.
Good.
Good night. Get on, you go off.
See ya.
I see our friend Kevin should be calling any second now.
Good night, everyone.
Okay, good night. All right. Anyway, let me see here. Let's wait. I saw that Kevin came online, so that might... Yeah, there he is. Okay. Add him to the group. Kevin is we keep getting like almost full houses. Jeff Stein is starting to call now. It pops up and says Jeff Stein is coming online, so then I add him to the group. There we go. Kevin, are you there? Kevin?
Yeah.
Kevin.
I'm here.
Yeah, but we can't see you because your camera is in a weird place. It's like there you go.
He's got the tape over it again.
Oh, is that the thing you do to?
I don't want Phil spying on me.
You know, I mean, you're
wearing a Phil T-shirt.
Yeah.
You know, Mark Zuckerberg, he puts tape over his webcam.
Well, here, see this thing. Can you see that?
Yeah.
No.
You see it?
No, no.
I'm trying to
go to your left.
Oh, here,
right.
here we go. See that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Write a little more.
Huh?
Write a little more. There we go.
Anyway, that goes on your camera. It comes with, it now comes with the cameras, and you just put it over there, and you can blank out your camera.
A piece of cardboard and a paper clip.
Some people
too.
Are getting.
If anybody really wants to see what's going on my webcam, have at it.
I feel the same way. You want to see me naked? Go right ahead.
Oh!
It will be an image. It will
enjoy
be.
The
it
show.
Will be. It'll be an image that lingers with you for the rest of your life. Okay. Hi, Jeff. How are you this evening?
Good. I'm doing great. How about yourself?
Good. And Rob, how are you doing this evening?
Good.
Oh, good, it's Rob.
Yeah, it's good to not see you in a hotel room. I can tell you what hotel rooms you're in by the back of the bed, you know.
Yeah, I'm always laying on the bed.
Yeah, well, that's the way to do it. I mean, what are you going to do? You're going to sit up for 2 hours?
You need a room with a desk.
Yeah. Exactly.
Now, there's a desk. Why would I want to sit at a desk, though? Can lay on the bed.
I do when I call in from a hotel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean that's you. But I mean, some people just like to relax. You know.
That's right.
Yeah. So anybody want to kick off any topics tonight?
Who knows?
I mean,
because luckily this show has gotten off to a fairly smooth start. Okay.
True. Yeah.
In that, I haven't had to do a whole deal with the camera. Yeah, with the camera thing.
I wish I could say the same.
Anyway, so let me start recording something here anyway, just to have a backup. Okay. Anyway, so I guess we'll start off with Obama. Probably end with Obama. But I imagine now that the healthcare thing is geschwinkto. It's over and done with.
They didn't have the vote, didn't they pull it?
They pulled it.
Because
they knew they couldn't get the votes. That's right. why they pulled it.
Embarrassment.
Yeah.
There's another problem. If they had the vote and it went down, then they couldn't introduce it again.
Yes, they could.
No, yeah, they can't. Absolutely. You just reintroduce it as a new bill with some new bells and whistles.
They would have had to wait a year. It was something about the budget committee there was something that had to be done before the bill to determine the amount that it was going to cost.
Like the reconciliation.
Well, here is something that he should have learned from the Clintons is your first order of business should not be health care. because when Clinton tried it, it hurt his presidency for several years in trying to get other stuff passed. Obama waited for a while before he actually pushed for his health care. I think, in fact, if I'm not mistaken, he did it towards the end of his first term in office.
I like Rob's theory, which I believe it was Rob that said, you tell the Congress and the Senate that they have to give us the same deal that they have. And if they don't, that's the one they have to take.
And that's wonderful, Phil, that you feel that way, but good luck with that.
It's
not going to happen.
Yeah. I mean, you're asking guys who give themselves raises.
That would be a great way to do that. They would go for that.
Well, I think that they should be pushed to go for that. I think that's the right way to do it.
Listen, I think all the people in Congress should also have to live on food stamps and live within that budget.
Right, that'd be great.
You know, things that would give them a life lesson. All right.
Good idea.
You know, no, really, I'm serious. Because that would give them a life lesson. Or tell them, for the next month, you have to live on just so much, you and your family.
They make about 180 G's a year. You know, they should get food stamps.
I think they make 160. Yes. I think they make 160.
What's your salary?
They make 160.
160?
Yeah, they make more than a talk.
They're under the poverty level for Washington, no, D.C.
They should live on the salary of a Walmart employee.
They make more than a talk show host.
Yeah, but they got to maintain two households and one for their mistress. You know, it's tough on that kind of money.
I know, it's very rough. Very rough.
We should have a telethon or something.
But they were saying today that this is very bad for Trump because this is going to slow him down on everything he's doing.
Okay. We'll see.
No, it's not we'll see. This is how the nature of things. I mean, it put an arrow in the foot of Clinton for a while. It certainly, although Obama was successful with it, he got something through.
Yeah, he did his stimulus package first, I think.
Yeah.
That was the first thing he did.
Yeah. So, I mean, first he had to take care of the stock market, which was in the dumps. Okay.
That was Bush's stimulus.
No, that wasn't Bush.
He used half of it. Obama used the other half, which was the $700 million, I think.
The stimulus wouldn't pass until after
Obama... He distributed and bailed out banks with the first $700 million. And then when he was asked about Obama using it, I remember Bush saying, that's up to him if he wants to use it or not, the balance of it.
Hmm. Yeah, okay. He did what he had to do. It was an emergency situation at the time.
Right. But there was already, I think it was $1.5 trillion that was allocated. Was a trillion a billion? $1.5 billion? No,
I don't know.
Yeah, I can't remember.
I really don't remember. Nothing.
But 750 of it, whether it was billion or million, I think it was billion, was used by Bush, and the other 750 was used by Obama.
Mm, that was nice deal they cut there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the art of the deal. Yeah, Trump was such a great deal maker. You know,
that book was written by a ghostwriter.
Well, it wasn't a ghostwriter. His name is on the front of the book.
Okay,
I can't remember what the guy's name was now.
Yeah,
he has since said that Trump is full of shit.
Yeah. Well, my daughter is probably the best deal negotiator. When she was 2 or 3 years old, I used to say, you put your night-night clothes on, you brush your teeth, and then you go to bed, and that's the deal. And she looks at me and she says, Daddy, no, that's not the deal. And I thought that was the cutest. No, it's not the deal.
And all she had to do was do that, and she got to stay up a little later, right? Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, I mean, little kids and dogs are the best sellers of stuff. Yeah. You know, a dog is like a politician, you know. He's always politicking for something, like, you know, a biscuit or something.
I know these kids, like the littlest ones, like they know, they're so adept at using their cuteness to manipulate you.
Yes, yes.
As a substitute teacher, it happens quite a bit.
Yeah.
You know, my last year in high school, I needed another credit or two, and they had me go to a kindergarten, and I was assisting in the kindergarten, and it was like those kids were miniature adults. They might have been like 5 years old, but the only difference between them and somebody that was 25 was their size. You know, they were like fully developed people, except miniature. Have you noticed that?
Well,
I got a 11-year-old.
Now, one thing I'll tell you is that since I went to school, and now that I'm older and teaching, especially girls, I think it's because of hormones in the milk. They're developing like a year earlier than they were like when I was a kid, at least a year.
That 7-year-old looks like an 8-year-old, you know.
Well, I'm talking about because like hormones in the milk. I don't want to get weird or perverse about it. It sounds like Phil was getting a little into weirdo territory there.
No, it's not the deal.
So I guess Obamacare stays.
That's right.
Obamacare
until it explodes, as he says.
Yeah.
Yeah. But
when it explodes, he'll tell us all about it.
But what's he going to do when it explodes? If he says he's not going to do anything now, he's not going to do anything later.
Yep.
Well, they're going to make it explode.
They've already done that.
They're going to help it along, that's for sure.
The sky is falling.
No, wait a minute. Phil, Trump said it today. Did you hear him?
No, I haven't listened to his remarks.
Trump said exactly that. It's terrible. It's going to fail. It's going to blow up.
Yeah. He said that for a long time.
He said, and remember, it's a Democratic plan. We had nothing to do with it. But he's going to be blamed, and Congress, the Republican Congress, will be blamed for not fixing it.
I think Ryan's going to be blamed for not getting the people under him that he needed to pass whatever they want to pass.
You know, the one thing he did say was, he's not going to blame Ryan for this. He did a great job, blah, blah, blah. But I'll bet you when it comes 2020 election time, he'll be throwing that guy under the bus like no tomorrow.
He's not running in 2020.
Next week. What are you talking about, 2020? Yeah,
I don't think he'll be able to get elected again.
I don't think so either. Wait a minute.
I think he could get elected the first time.
Hold on a second. This is a new one from Phil.
Yeah, but now he's going to have a record that somebody can attack. You see, it's easy to be the guy that has no record. But, you know, once he has 4 years behind him.
Oh, I'm sure that after four years, he'll still have no record.
Yeah, he'll be there for 4 years unless he gets arrested.
Unless he gets arrested.
Jeff, how do you feel about the fact that now all of a sudden it looks like Obamacare is still here? Well, you're not affected by it, neither am I.
Not really, but other than my kids and things like that.
Yeah.
And my wife was jumping around the house so happy about the fact that that it failed.
Yeah.
Well, I am affected by it because the one good thing John Kasich did was accept the Medicaid expansion, and that covers me. So thanks for Obama and thanks to John Kasich, believe it or not.
Can you explain something to me? Because I know I'm on Medicare, but I'm not on Medicaid. Somebody explain. Dan, you say you get Medicaid.
Right.
How do you get Medicaid? And what is it?
Well, it's run the way they do it now is it is run via private companies, but through the subsidies. And I'm still going through my deductible, so it's not saving me much money yet. I do take a few prescription drugs because I'm a
so Medicaid fat guy. is really a form of getting you health insurance.
Correct,
Done by the
way county. The way it is now, it used to be completely a public thing, but now it's run through private entities. It's via private entities, and therefore I still, like right now, I'm still going through my deductible, and that will hopefully end very soon. So
there's something in California or in Contra Costa County called Contra Costa Community Services or something that is like Medicaid, I would guess, but it's provided by the county. Mm-hmm. Because when I was looking for different hospitals to do the proton therapy, that was one of the things that they accepted. Whereas, you know, Kaiser didn't want to pay for that. But, you know, one of the things was this county medical that I guess is provided to people of low income.
Yeah.
And it's actually pretty good. I think it covers everything. But and there's no deductible for the Contra Costa one.
Mm-hmm.
I
tended to think that Medicaid was like for poor people and that it was a state subsidized Medicare for people who were not, you know, 65 and over.
Right. It was for like the very, very poor. But now it's just children, like for too. The kind of poor.
The kind of poor?
Yeah.
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 I'm kind of poor. I'm not super duper poor.
Yeah. I'm Jewish, so I'm Yom Kippur. geez, that was a terrible one. Jeff, so you say your wife was elated by...
she's so happy.
Now, is she on Medicare, too?
No.
No? You got a younger wife.
I have a younger wife.
Okay.
So she gets... she has to pay out of her out of her success. Let's put it that way.
Out of her success?
Yeah.
In other words, she's not working right now.
She's not working.
So she's not on any medical plan. So she has to buy a medical plan.
She buys a medical plan.
Yeah. And what kind of medical plan does she buy? I mean, who is it, like United or somebody like that?
I guess so. I don't remember the name right now.
If you don't mind me asking, how much does she have to check out every month for?
Let me try to find out.
I mean, Phil is doing, you know, shelling out what, $900 a month, is it, Phil, for yourself?
$1,007 now.
Pamela?
Holy shit.
Yeah. No. Yeah. Because it's interesting what insurance is costing today.
Bam.
It is just, it's phenomenal. Bob, you're on, are you on anything like Medicare or whatever?
I'm on Medicare.
Yeah. I hesitate to ask people that because then if they say, no, I'm too young, it sounds like an insult, you know.
$800 a month?
And Jeff, I'm sure, has Medicare. And then, I don't know, what do you supplement with?
I just found out that my wife pays for her stuff. $800 a month.
Oh, wow. That's a lot of money. That really is.
Yeah, it is.
And she's perfectly healthy and all of that.
Is she?
And she's not pregnant.
No, is she close to 60 or, you know, or is she like 50 to 55? Well, you know, what, because I'm 62 and so my
32.
No.
By the way, Jeff, turn your camera on.
Because
on video you look much better than your picture.
Oh,
so in Connecticut, it was probably a different cost of insurance, and I have, I think it's called an HMO, and maybe that's cheaper than.
That means a homosexual works on you.
I'm sure they do, but. But,
yeah, that's a health maintenance rather than a PPO, which is a preferred provider.
Yeah. A PPO. Now, PPO is what Trump
you
wants.
You may be 77, but you act like you're 12.
That's what that's what Trump wants is a PPO.
Russian PPO.
Russian PPO. Oh, boy. You know, we could all of us who are on Medicare, tell Phil that he has something really decent to look forward to, right?
I am looking forward to it, but listen to this.
Security to the ER.
What was that?
Security to the ER. It's
yeah, that's okay. You don't have to play it again.
Drops.
Huh? Yes, Scott is, Scott is looking embarrassed. That's an embarrassed look?
No, it's just another Philism.
Yeah. You're the when Phil's not here, you talk a lot. But when he's here,
he doesn't.
Yes, he does.
Yeah, only when he's the only one there, and he does it as a mercy screw for you.
As a mercy screw for me?
Yeah, yeah. You know, if it's just him and you, he talks.
Well, maybe because I let him. And I draw him out.
No. Yeah.
Yes, Dan.
Okay. Let me tell you something from the perspective of somebody who's been listening a lot but not been on.
Mm-hmm.
When I listen, a lot of times, I feel like I'm listening to Alex Bennett moderating the Phil and Rob Crossfire show.
Phil, you ignorant bastard.
Yeah, like Alex is just narrating, and mostly Phil.
Listen,
I mean, Phil's you know, Phil knows how to weasel his way into the conversation.
You know, it's my pleasure. It's my pleasure when I can sit back and not say anything and just let you people have at it. That's the art of doing a show like this. I jump in when things are slowing down. Yes, Scott.
I told my wife tonight, I said that if it's a full house, you know, I said, you've been having a lot of people in here lately, so I didn't call in last night. But I said, I don't know why I do it anyway, because if there's nine people out there, it's Al, it, Phil's doing half the talking. You can't get in.
But you got to remember, I'm the guy that gets attacked. So, you know, I got to respond to the attacks. And so I'm
you don't have to respond to every attack.
Violin's playing for
Phil. Yeah.
Hey, when there's a full house, there's nine of you picking on it.
No, but I mean, when you're not here, Phil, I'll be honest with you. When you're not here, everybody else talks more. Because you do have a tendency to suck the air out of the room.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just saying.
Or you could call it a conversation stimulant.
Well, I used to use the term hijack the show, but I wouldn't let him do that. Jeff.
I never see Phil raising his hand.
You know, you're right.
And that's the problem. He just blasts right in.
Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of treat it as a conversation, but I would raise my hand if it wasn't.
No, you don't treat it as a conversation. Who do you converse with?
You guys.
When you come on, when you do your part on the show, it's a monologue, and then maybe if there's some air that hasn't been sucked out of the room, Jeff can breathe and say something.
All right. Hey. I'll mute. You guys go have a good time. Matter of fact, I wanted to watch. Don't get pissy on us.
Stick around. We like your participation. We're just saying that sometimes, you know.
Then suck it up and take my participation. And plus, I've been watching Iron Fist and Justified. I watch one Iron Fist and I watch one Justified. And it's pretty good.
I watched all of Iron Fist.
Yeah,
and it sucked.
Really, I'm almost done.
Compared
with the first
to Jessica season. Jones and Luke Cage and Daredevil,
Luke Cage is real good.
The problem is it only got a 19 on the Rotten Tomatoes. The problem with it is it's not a bad storyline, and most of the performances are good. The lead person is terrible.
He's the blonde guy?
Yeah, he's terrible. Yes, Dan.
You were talking about Netflix, and since you're such a big student of comedy as well, did you see those Dave Chappelle things?
No, I haven't yet. No.
They're really, really good. Dave Chappelle is, I don't know how well you like him as a comic, but I really do.
I liked his show. I wasn't crazy like other people were about his show, but I liked it.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, have you seen him just do stand up? Because that's what this is. It's really
good. No, I haven't. But
okay.
You'll
like it, I think.
It better be good because he got paid $80 million to do these two shows.
That's a lot.
He better be goddamn fucking funny and give a blowjob with each ticket. You know.
Each new one subscription show? To Netflix.
No, but for two shows. But they're running both shows now, aren't they? Aren't there two of them?
Yeah, there's two. One was a show he did in Santa Fe, and one was a show he did in Austin, Texas.
Yeah, he decided he was going to get $80,000 to do two shows, so he'd do them both at the same time and take the money and run.
Well, $80,000.
$80 million.
He had solid material for both shows. It's not like anything repeated.
You may remember the money he walked away from, which was considered considerable, was at Comedy Central when he walked away from a contract on $50 million. Right. So he turned around and made $80 million from Netflix for just two goddamn shows.
Yep. I guess he knows how to make a deal better than Trump does.
Where do they got that kind of money to spend on a kid, you know, for comedy? Well, you know, there's not even any advertisements on Netflix.
Netflix makes its money by people subscribing to Netflix, and when they put a Dave Chappelle on there and people want to see him, they subscribe.
Yeah.
And so that means more money in their pockets. I mean, right now they have maybe double the subscribership of HBO.
Yeah. Well, HBO is not strong anymore.
What is that?
It sounds like a
driving a truck.
No. No, Tony isn't here, so it can't be outside his window.
It's Kevin. Kevin's my damn clock. It's my clock.
It's your clock.
What kind of clock sounds like that?
What do you think, Rob? $80 million for two comedy hours.
What's that?
What do you think about the money Chappelle's getting?
I don't know. I haven't seen Chappelle in such a long time. I like this show. Is it worth that much money? I don't know.
Yeah. I mean,
a little bit too they could get a little bit, you know, too. They start paying talent too much money and wind up in trouble.
Well, here's what I'm going to wait and see.
That's what happened with Chappelle the first
time. Well, here's what we will know after this is over. If they come back and offer him another two shows for another $80 million, then we know it was worth the money to them.
Are you sure that it was just those two shows?
Yes, he's got yes. $8 million it's for two for the two shows.
More stuff down the line.
For the two shows, and they're talking about other stuff down the line. But if they come back and offer him another $80 million for the same amount of work, you can bet your goddamn life that they made money off of it, that they saw an audience out of it.
Is each one of these shows a single appearance, or is it a group of shows?
It's actually the way they have it set up is the it's two episodes on the same thing, and it's just like two episodes.
So it's four shows.
So the show is two episodes long.
Yeah, but there's it's basically stand up, right? It's not sketch.
Yeah, it's just him
is there some sketch comedy?
Really good. He's got some great stuff.
Is there some sketch comedy in there?
No, no. He's got an intro by Morgan Freeman, if that's worth anything.
Well, that cost him $20 million. So
some really good jokes on there. Good Cosby stuff.
Now, is this all black comedians?
Well, Dave Chappelle is a black comedian, yes.
Well, you know, when a white comedian has a show, he gets some black guys on it. Now, there's no tit for tat. This guy's
No. It's just him.
It's just him.
It's just him. It's not him with gas. It's just him.
Yeah,
he's got to be awfully funny for $40 million an episode. There,
he's funny. Watch it. I recommend it. Everyone watch it.
Yeah. He's all I'm saying is that we'll see if he's worth it. If he's worth it, you know, it's like Marvel's doing probably pretty well for them because they keep buying up shows. I think they only had a deal for four, and now with the Defenders coming up in September, they're up to about six, so they've renewed that deal with
Defenders,
Marvel.
Defenders are kind of like the poor man's Avengers, right?
Well, the Avengers of this eco sphere.
Avengers Junior.
Well, yeah, it's Iron Fist, Jessica Jones. Is it Jessica Jones? Is that the name of the character? Jessica
Luke
Jones,
Cage.
Luke Cage, and Daredevil.
Daredevil.
I haven't seen Daredevil yet. Is that a new one?
Daredevil, they've done two runs of that already.
Oh.
Yeah. No, that was the original Marvel show on Netflix, and it's very good.
I got to get through this Iron Fist. Plus, Faye likes it. So.
Well, Jessica Jones is much better, and Luke Cage I loved.
I loved it because it drifted away.
It was shot here in Harlem. So, you know, I could go, oh, I know that street corner, and I know that street corner. And
you could be an extra.
Yeah.
What does extra pay now? Still $50?
Huh? By the way, whoever is calling me right now is trying to call me. Let me do this.
You want to turn your camera on, Alex?
Well, no. Is my camera off? Oh.
It's
there,
been off.
There, oh, there, I'll turn it on. Let me see here. Who was trying to call? I have no idea who was trying to call, but you cannot call using our other. Excuse me, folks, we're watching TV. We went off for a second there.
Brian.
Huh? Well, it didn't look. But you can't call using if like last night you called. Now you're trying to call using the group history. There's no way you can get in that way because I'm going to have to hang up on you. Because obviously, oh, here we go. It's Brian. Yeah. Here we go. Add to group call. Hello, Brian. How are you this evening?
Not too bad. Late night. That's why I'm calling you. Out.
A late night. Okay. By the way, let me talk a little louder if you can, Brian, because your phone is a little on the weak side tonight. Okay. We're one away from a full house again, right?
That's right.
Did we have a full house last night?
Yes.
Yes? So if we have a full house tonight, that will be a whole week of nothing but full houses.
Wow. That's awesome.
Good. Yeah.
So pretty soon you'll have to get an apartment building.
pretty soon you'll have to charge, like, do advertising or something. Yeah. Think of these little Dollar Shave Clubs. You could do ads for razors on the show.
Yeah, right.
Adam and Eve is also, they do a lot of advertising on podcasts, I've noticed.
Right, yeah.
What's Adam and Eve? Sex stuff?
Yeah, but still, you know, money's money, right?
I guess
money. Well, hey, you know, you did this stuff for Midnight Blue, that'd be perfect.
Well, I mean, I used to make commercials for Midnight Blue.
Alex remembers when there was sex.
But I'm one of the few people here who can say I've actually done ads for whorehouses.
Yeah. There we go. Advertise the whorehouses.
Yeah. And I made them look good, too. I made them look glamorous. I even made, there was this one place, I swear to you, it was on 42nd Street, where you would go in and it was a peep show, and there were women standing around giving blowjobs. Behind the curtain, when you go into the peep show, okay? And they wanted, it was called The Lucky Lady, and they wanted me to do an ad for them. I made that thing look so glamorous, you know, of a woman coming in and going, hey, you know, kind of like, you know, it was all done in pantomime while the announcer was saying, you know, you looking for a good time tonight? And then she leads him into a peep show room behind the curtain. And it was a wonderful commercial. I'm very proud of it. I wish I still had a copy of it. But basically, it was just a place that they used to have a problem in these peep shows with spermatozoa. Is that the best way to put it? And
come on the wall.
Well, against the wall and on the floors and so on.
Ceiling.
And there was a person in every one of these peep shows whose job it was to mop up the sperm.
Yeah.
And they called him, you ready for this? The scum dubber.
Scum dubber.
Yeah.
You want to play that commercial on GabNet.
Yeah. You know, use it as a filler.
Yeah, we're looking for scum dubbers.
No. Play the commercial you made.
What happens is if you just tuned in tonight, and this is the first time you've ever tuned in, you have learned something from me.
Yeah, I never heard of scum dubbers.
You never heard of scum dubbers before. So if you're in private conversation with somebody about something, blah, 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 blah. Oh, by the way, do you know the people who used to clean up the spermatozoa in the peep shows were called scum dubbers? And everybody will go, that's amazing. I did not know that.
Yeah, you'll be the life of the party.
You think you'd get health care if you had a job like that?
No. I would hope you do.
Yeah. It's got to be a job code.
Alex.
Yes.
For the government.
Yes.
I was just going to say, I didn't know what that, I never knew that word existed, that term existed, but when you put it in the context, in the atmosphere, as far as the atmosphere of what they work in is concerned, I have to say it's not much different than what you would encounter in a bathhouse.
Yeah.
Let me see here.
Except a bathhouse has a glory hole.
Hmm.
Right?
Yeah, among other things. In jacuzzi, ours, jacuzzi and a workout center, though nobody goes there.
I thought the bathhouse, nothing ever gets to the floor.
For the people watching the show, the show, the reason the screen went blank there for a moment is I had to go over. I had a friend, John Rockwell, an old friend who used to work with me on Midnight Blue, who just called. John, what I did is I just asked you to ask to be a contact. And as soon as you do that, I can then do, you know, put you on as a contact, and then you can just call into the show. Either that, or just to any of you who want to call, never called before, you go up to where it says contacts, go add contact, and then say you want us. No, he's not there yet. Oh, boy.
Can you call him back?
I'm trying to do that, but his problem is he's not listed on the contact list, and so therefore it doesn't say add contact to the group. So, yeah. John, let me tell you this again if you're listening. He probably isn't listening. You've got to, let's see here, go online and ask to be, you know, in fact, I just said add contact, and it supposedly notified you, and you just have to okay that, and then I will be able to have you call. That's the simplest way that this is working.
Your picture's not on.
My picture is not on. There we go.
If he calls, you'll have a full house.
Yes, if he does call, we will have a full house. But wait a minute. Let me see here. Is he There we go. Add to group. Okay. Let me see here. I got to get rid of this. And John, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here now.
Okay, see, we have a full house now. And John, if you have
problem is that on Gabnet, I'm behind. It's like I'm hearing you 5 seconds later or something like that. I think it works better if I watch you on YouTube or something like that. It's more real time. Listen to the audio on Gabnet.
Turn off the audio feed of the show so you don't hear that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, mute the tab.
I just got put on the Facebook for some reason. Here we go.
Yeah, okay. just mute the tab.
This is all new for me.
Yeah.
I know I've asked about it before.
Yeah, okay, so can you hear me now?
Okay, I turned off the 24/7 feed.
Yeah,
and
good.
I hear you.
Okay, good.
And I see you in a little cam thing.
That's right. Now, we'll do one other thing. Have you got a camera?
I've got a camera.
Along the bottom, it says there's a picture of a camera. Just click on that, and let's see if it turns on.
Do you want to show other participants' videos?
The bottom, there is like a camera.
I want to show the videos, right?
I guess.
Bottom of your screen.
I see Phil here.
Yeah,
and I'm looking. Well, I see. I've got to look around. Is that a camera?
Yeah. Along the bottom, you'll see a camera, a microphone, a bunch of other gazorchinists, and so on. Click on the camera.
I don't actually see that, but this is. I don't know. This is weird.
Pull your cursor down to the bottom.
Yeah.
Skype. Right. And I'm looking under. If I look under home, it might show up. Right.
No. Do you see little circles at the bottom with icons?
There should be four circles, and it's the one on the far right.
Yeah. Video message.
No. Yes. Video. Yeah, well.
Video. Yes, but not message.
Yeah.
Oh, I know. That's what's weird.
If you just roll your mouse down to the bottom,
Let's not work overtime on this.
I'll work on it while you guys. I'll work on it while
yeah.
you guys.
Yeah. Anyway, join in whenever you want to, and just say, "Hey, it's John here. I want to say something," and then say something.
Okay. Well, let me see if I can figure this out.
To most people, technology. Yeah.
Actually, you don't need to see me. You can see the picture. Right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Just what you need, of course, is another old white guy with a beard.
How many beards do we have here?
I'll keep working on it.
Does that constitute a beard, Scott? Yeah. What you have?
Jeff raised his
hand. Yeah, Dan has a beard. Kevin definitely has a beard. Rob, do you have a mustache or is there a beard there?
I got a goatee thing.
No, happened. Rob.
A goatee? But it's gray on the bottom.
Okay. John has got a beard. Let's see here. Jeff's got a beard. I got a beard. Brian, you don't have one, right?
No, I do not.
It's some guy you know who pretends to be just a friend, right? some woman who pretends to be just a friend. And Bob Eberth, of course, doesn't have a beard.
Let's see.
So anyway, what were we talking about? Oh, scum dubbers. Okay. And of course now John would know this term because John worked with me on Midnight Blue. In fact, John has a distinction. He was the only guy with a car, and so he was known as the transportation guy. But we misspelled transportation on the credits, and it read transpiration. Right, John?
Right.
And so we always refer to him after that as transpiration.
But we never changed it.
We liked it so much that we just kept it transpiration.
See how many people, I don't think anybody even noticed, really. I mean, you know, who looks at credits? Except me.
Yeah.
And the people that are on the credits.
When I used to
go. Serendipitous discovery.
I'd go to movies with Alex, and he stayed for the credits and would watch them all. The whole theater was empty, but he'd be watching the credits.
You know why?
Why?
If I liked the movie, that was my form of applause.
I see.
That was me saying, I'm willing to look at all these names because somewhere some guy who's just one of a thousand names there. Yeah. Worked hard on that, and it should go past my eyes, and that's my way of saying I appreciate your work.
Susan always liked the title Best Boy, you know?
Yeah.
Best Boy. Yeah, that was...
Yeah. Yeah. There's, of course, the key grip, right. You know.
They're all their grip, I think, too. Right?
Did you have any jobs like that with us, John? Did we ever call you anything else like... a key grip or a gopher or whatever.
Producer.
anyways, John, I've known John since the Midnight Blue days, and it goes back to 1965?
70s.
75, excuse me.
75. 75.
So that's how many years now?
Over 40.
Over 40
years? It's a long time ago, kiddo.
John and I have known each other.
Yeah, over 40 years.
And believe me, in the time that we worked at Midnight Blue, we saw a lot of spermatozoa.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
Huh?
What were we gonna whatever Alex didn't edit, I edited. So we saw a lot.
Yes. What were you saying, Scott?
Nothing.
Oh. Because we had to edit out the spermatozoa because it was cable. So, you know.
Oh, wait a minute. You once showed me a thing where Susan was doing the microphone, and there was a gal that screwed like 100 guys.
Yeah, we did a thing called, ask John about it. He remembers the spermathon, don't you? This is one of my proudest achievements in show business, was the spermathon.
You had to do what you got to do to get to where you're at, right?
You know, there's a time in your life in which you just don't give a shit about your future.
They make a commemorative trophy plaque in honor of your accomplishment?
Yeah, exactly. So what I did was I was watching, I think, I, Claudius, which was out at the time, and Messalina, who is one of the lead characters in I, Claudius, and I can't remember, I think somebody famous today played her. It wasn't Judy Dench. It might have been, what's her name? The other one. The one that isn't Judy Dench. and Messalina was famous in Rome for having fucked the entire Roman army or whatever. She had an orgy in which she fucked 100 guys. So I said, we should do a modern day equivalent of that. And so I did a thing called the Spermathon. And we got this woman who was willing to do it, and we had people write in applications to be part of the spermathon, and we did it at the Baths, right? It was at Plato's Retreat, which was the former Baths here in New York, gay bathhouse, and she had sex with 100 guys, and we videotaped the whole thing. You remember it, John? Tell them about it.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Well, that was a little, I think that was right before you started doing the full color Channel J sponsored show. I remember.
No,
watching,
no, that was part
of,
that was
all of that.
That was part of the sponsored show. Yeah.
No, oh,
that,
what? Yeah. It's okay.
Oh, yeah. That
I think
was
you left me home on that one.
Did I leave you home?
Somehow
on that?
I missed that one.
Here was the best part of the evening. More people showed up than we ever expected would show up. Okay. They all signed the releases to be on video too. I mean, it was amazing. But about halfway through, we realized we were running out of condoms.
Ooh.
And so I had to run down to a drugstore and I walk in and I say, I want to buy 50 condoms, please. And I think the guy said to me, hopeful, aren't you?
Well, I thought the deal was they only had to wear a condom if they penetrated, but she was given hand jobs,
yes,
blow jobs,
yes,
and those were without condom.
Right.
Yeah.
So anyway, and they couldn't. If they were going to have sex, whether they had to use a condom. We would probably still ever use a condom because of the whole AIDS thing, but this was pre-AIDS. Yeah. You know, we probably created AIDS with that event. Yeah.
Patient Zero was there.
Yeah. I can't believe I'm telling these stories. Jeff, do you have any less respect for me now?
Well, no, because I actually used to go to New York occasionally on business, and I could get to watch it.
Now you see why I don't raise my hand.
That's right. Yeah.
But, well, what were you going to say?
My question was, is it on YouTube now or not?
Should be.
The Spermathon itself, I don't know if it's on YouTube. Somebody bought up all the old tapes of Midnight Blue. Okay.
There's very little, Alex, yeah. There's very little Midnight Blue original material on YouTube. There was a guy who did reviews of some of the few ones that somebody, I think, long after we were gone, had put together a collection, two or three things, or maybe they were the last things Goldstein put together or something. That's it, because I looked.
I know what that was about, and that was a guy who, when Goldstein went belly up, went in and for $5,000 bought up all the Midnight Blue stuff, which pissed my friend Steve Gruberg and I off because we had offered him more. You know,
Alex, you had showed me the Spermathon on VHS tape. Is that in your storage?
I have no idea. But let me finish what I was saying. But he managed to buy the whole kit and caboodle from Al. So now he's putting out these tapes, and I get a hold of him and I say, you do realize I'm on these tapes. You know, I didn't appear in Midnight Blue that much. I think you know that, John. I didn't appear physically. But it was amazing how much I did appear because he managed to pull everything where I had appeared, you know, an interview with Marilyn Chambers or an interview with somebody or a reporting from somewhere. And I said, show me a release on me. And he said, well, I can't do that. I said, why? He said, well, we don't have any releases. And I said, bingo. I said, I want to be able to use any of the stuff for my own purposes. And he said, okay, I'll give you the rights to do that. He never went ahead with it. And I'm wanting him to do it. I want to do it now because there are some videos there I'd like to lay my hands on. But he actually has the whole... You know what we call the master tapes, John, or what do we call them? I guess we call them the master tapes. I would love to be able to lay my hands on them. But it's old stuff. It was a lot of work. I'm tapes 1 through 40, I think, and then I left.
Well, if you ask Damien, maybe he can find you had a VHS tape of the Spermathon, because you showed it to me, and we watched it.
I really can't tell you. I don't remember what I have and don't have. I do know I have some old, you know, there's stuff. I'll tell you, the trouble with video now, with old video, is that they are in different formats.
And those VHS,
the VHS, it wouldn't be a good enough copy that I would want to use that. Because in those days, every time you made a copy, it degenerated. Do you ever work with video, Rob?
Yes.
So you know what I'm talking about. If you took a pretty good 3/4-inch video, mm-hmm. and then you made a copy of it, the copy would degenerate. Today, one generation. Yeah. Today with digital, it doesn't degenerate.
Right.
So you could take a master tape, convert it to files today and be perfect. But in the old days, so every time, like maybe, you know, it was the video, but then I had the video of the show, which was one generation down, and I made a copy of that, and now it's two generations down.
And it gets all grainy and...
Gets grainy, the color is kind of spotty. John knows what I'm talking about, right, John?
Oh, yeah.
John, I think, did a very important job at Midnight Blue. You became the go-to guy for Rod Swenson to edit videotapes of Wendy O. Williams. And in fact...
Initially when he was doing...
Sex shows.
Right. The sex shows that were put on after, I think, what was it? A-Beam decided they were going to clean up Times Square. So you weren't... they didn't want to have live sex shows, or I think it was Show World downtown there, across the street from the bus station, whatever.
Avenue.
He was giving them video to go on a projection screen so they wouldn't get busted for having live
and
nude
he did,
girls,
he,
I guess.
He did,
like
he did
that.
These amazing and, videos. He did these amazing videos like Wendy O. Williams and another woman in 100 gallons of oil, you know, rolling around. Remember stuff like that, right, John?
Very something like that.
Very
yeah.
inventive and very artful.
Well, mostly we did promos, sort of. You know, I think he had probably gotten a lot of the stuff pre-recorded because I didn't get to do a lot of the longer form things. It was mostly, you know, what's the next thing coming up on our video? And they were pretty funny. They were almost like little promos you see on TV for you know, The Walking Dead or something.
Or he, but he, we do. They were
walking nude.
They were artful though, because I know once when I was when I was doing some editing for him, I looked at Rod and I said, "Rod, you know this is art." And he said, "Yes, I know it. That's what I'm trying to do here. I'm trying to bring art to the masses." He and Wendy were amazing, just amazing. But here's another thing about John that you may not know, but I remember. How many here have heard of the Plasmatics?
I have.
Rob has, Phil has, Bob has, Jeff has.
But I can't remember.
John was a member of the Plasmatics, right, John?
Oh, yeah. Well, I became one when they needed somebody. He decided he wanted to do videos, you know, pre-MTV.
Yeah.
He wanted to do some rock videos and artsy sort of videos for some of the songs. And so I helped not only record but edit those. And since we were doing that, it's sort of like, oh, you know, can you come along and sort of be a roadie, put up the videos, put up the TV screens, hang them up at CBGB's, and then we'll run the video before we start the show and all that sort of stuff. And it just sort of went from there for a couple of, I think almost 2 years, year, almost something like that.
But didn't you also appear on stage with them occasionally?
Oh, I was on stage too. Or, well, I mean, you wouldn't know because I, you know, there were a couple of us who would be on stage or off stage with hoods on our heads and butcher aprons, or what they call butcher aprons. I think they were lab coats, all stained with fake blood, you know, sending things over, giving her the chainsaw to cut up a guitar with or whatever.
Yeah. Know? Well, you know, I'll tell you, her death really was one of the...
I actually did get to play on one.
One of her death was one of the saddest things that I can remember because she was.
Yeah,
people did not know this about Wendy. Wendy would go on stage and she'd have the chainsaw and she'd be cutting guitars in half and she'd be, you know, just this hellish woman. But off, she was the sweetest, nicest. Am I right, John? She was
absolutely.
She was amazing.
She was a lovely person.
I mean, I saw
very nice. I think she was. If not vegan, I mean, she loved animals, you know, they had a farm up in Connecticut toward the Plasmatics. Unfortunately, they found her dead at the farm.
Well, she killed her. She shot herself while she was in the forest because she wanted to be with the animals she loved.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Well, I was out of town or something, came back and there she was, you know, it's like, whoa. You know, how does that happen? But, you know, I don't know. I mean, they went from sort of punk to metal and try to make her into the metal priestess or something like that. And that didn't work as well, I think, as the original as the original punk group.
But a lovely,
and
lovely.
It sort of fizzled out there by 81, 2, 3, something like that.
But a lovely person. Lovely person. So anyway, yes,
Boy, I
Jeff.
Still can't find. I still can't find that.
Don't worry about it, John.
I can find a video camera on my Skype page here, but I'm looking.
Okay. Yes,
should I
Jeff.
Call or something? I don't know.
No, don't worry about it. Don't get obsessed by
not
it.
Not that I'm really dressed that well or anything.
Oh, well, then don't worry about it. Jeff, wants to say something.
I have a question. When you put that show on, was it live or did you pre-process the film?
Which are you talking about? You mean the Plasmatics performances?
No. Oh. I'm talking about Blue.
Midnight Blue? Oh, no. It was pre-recorded. The whole show was completely pre-recorded.
So who used to process the film?
Very well edited.
It wasn't
too.
A matter of processing the film. It was video.
It was all video.
It was all video. We were the first people to really use video a lot like that. And we, in fact, put out one hardcore tape which we had to convince. I don't know if you remember this, John, but we actually had to convince one of the porno people, one of the porno distributors, that we wanted to do the thing on videotape. And the guy said, how much will it cost for you to make an hour and a half porn film? And I said, $300. And he went, what? And I said, yeah. He says, here's the $300. And I came back and we actually saved, I think. I only spent $240. You know?
How much did the film make?
I don't know to this day. It was called Midnight Blue Uncensored, and you will not find my name on it anywhere. You remember that, John, right? John? Are you there, John?
I think you lost him.
Maybe we
I am. Oh, but you're cutting in and out a little bit. I'm on the Gabnet webpage.
Yeah.
And you're Skype, you're in your little
don't listen to the audio on the Gabnet page.
I'm hearing it from, I guess, Skype, actually, I guess.
Yeah, that's where you should be listening to it from. Well, let me get around to a couple of other little topics here besides my tawdry, horrible past, which I've now admitted to everybody. Do you think less of me, Jeff?
I knew all about it.
Oh, okay. Where'd you find out about it?
Well, I saw it on TV a number of times.
Yeah.
Like I say, occasionally I go to New York and I'm watching TV and I go, holy shit, what is this?
Yeah.
And I think maybe you talked about it when you were on your previous TV show.
It's the closest I've ever come to being involved with something that was a phenomenon. And the phenomenon only lasted 8 weeks before they took us off the air. You remember that too, John, right? But we started out non-commercially. We went for, about 16 episodes, 18 episodes. And then we went to the commercial channel and we were on for 8 weeks. The money was rolling in. You know, I'm sitting there with my feet up on the desk going, this is a phenomenon. And I mean, everybody was watching this thing. In fact, people I knew who were selling cable to customers would use Midnight Blue as a sales vehicle and told me they sold more subscriptions because of that than almost anything else except for Chinese broadcasting.
There you go, right.
Yeah. And one of the guys who was Chinese selling cable and told me this story wound up being the producer for David Letterman. And he said, you made me a lot of money in those days. It was a phenomenon. And but once we were taken off, and we got back on fairly fast, but once we were taken off, that killed it because it killed all the momentum. And people would come up to me and say, oh, gee, it's been years now since Midnight Blue's been taken off the air, right? I said, it's on Friday night, you asshole. You know, so, I mean, they killed our business.
I thought I knew you told me once how much you made at Midnight Blue.
Oh, nothing.
And it was like $12,000.
No, I didn't make $12,000.
No, I don't know why I remember that figure.
In fact, I think I actually sold my part of Midnight Blue to Goldstein when I left to go to California for like $15,000. Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. You know, that was it. You know, and so anyway. Anybody else see Midnight Blue besides you? You saw it, right, Phil, in the old days?
I only saw what you showed me. I was living in California in 75. And so you had shown me some videos at your old apartment in Sausalito. That's when I saw.
And a lot of people remember Midnight Blue, but they don't remember the Midnight Blue I did. They remember the one that the guys after me did.
Yeah.
Which I kind of liked. I thought it was okay. You know, but it wasn't what we did. We kind of did. We described what we were doing as a 60 minutes of sex, you know, that they were basically documentaries. It was basically chopped up into about four segments a show. And one would be what we called a video centerfold. Another one would be a thing called Speak Your Piece, in which we would have people, we'd have a question of the week and people would answer that. And we would also then go out and do things and see things, go out to, like, you know, gay strip shows and all kinds of stuff like that, you know.
Kind of like Real Sex on HBO?
Yeah. You know, Real Sex, actually, here's the funny part. We were taken off the air by the people who owned HBO, Time Incorporated at the time. And short time after that, they started Real Sex.
Yeah.
You know, they just didn't want the competition. And they said, oh, you're giving us a bad name and all that. We were no worse than what they were doing, you know.
So. If you had been 10 years later, you'd have gotten an outlet on the Playboy Channel.
Oh, actually, the Playboy Channel did bring me in, believe it or not, to talk to them about doing stuff. But it was one of those typical Hollywood meetings that you hear about where they go, you come on in, we're sitting down, nobody's walking out of this room without a deal. And we walked out of the room without a deal. Yeah.
Did they make you get on the casting couch?
Huh? No. No.
The casting couch.
Yeah. No. You know, what they really wanted to do was pick my brain for free is what they wanted to do. And I wouldn't let them do it. So, you know. Eh, scumbags everywhere, including on the walls of peep shows. Anyway, what else is there in the news? Let's see. We had the health care thing. Not go through, which really kills it for Trump, because a lot of his other stuff is going to fall by the wayside too. I can't see the wall being built. I don't think that's going to go through. What else isn't going to go? What else, Jeff? Do you anything else you don't think is going
to
go through?
I'm still looking to see what's happening with all the people who work for Trump right now who have relationships with Russia. Either permanently or previously time.
Now, what's his name? Manafort said that he really wants to speak to the committee.
Yeah.
Now, is that? Do you think he wants to do that to clear his name, or do you think he wants to do it because they fired him and he wants to rat on them?
No, I think he wants to clear his name.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He originally said he had nothing to do with it. Then somebody found out. And
he's been paid a lot of money. And yes. Said very
he represented
secretly.
That Ukrainian guy or something. He's had a lot of contact with Russia.
And he used to get $1 million a year to be a consultant or something like that.
$10 million.
$10 million.
$10 million.
Yeah.
What a deal!
Yeah. I'll do it. You know. I'll do it for five.
Is that $10 million from the Russians?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
As a consultant?
I can't think of his name. They were showing a video of him tonight on CNN. A guy that was an intermediary with Putin, to Putin.
Really?
Oh, and there was also another guy that I heard about, a Russian guy who worked for Putin, and yet Putin wouldn't vote for him again, and so he died just recently.
Yeah, just a couple of days ago, there was a Putin critic who, sleeping with the fishes now, right?
That's right.
Yeah. The question is, do you think Putin has him killed, or do you think it's just Putin's got a bad rep?
He's a nice guy.
Needs a better publicist.
Of course you're going to say that, Phil, because you like Trump and Trump likes Putin.
Bob's been quiet tonight, Bob Eberth. Bob, any comments about any of this going on with Trump?
Well, from what I've seen, a lot of Russians are dropping like flies lately.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And they all seem to have connections to either Putin or Trump.
Yeah.
They're draining the swamp. That's the way they do it out there.
Actually, what they do is they fill the swamp.
And they're always talking about the Clinton body count.
Sounds like they're trying to drain the tundra right now.
Well, I'm sure Phil feels this way. But does anybody feel that Trump is being treated badly? Or do you
not
think
he or Trump?
Well, I mean, I think you brought it up last night, Rob, that he's getting what he asked for.
That's right.
Right. Yeah. He earned it.
You know, and when he sits around acting like a baby, he should man up about it. You know, Instead, he babies out.
Yeah, Jeff.
I also have a sense that the way he became president, well, there was something about it that was, let's say, illegal. And I don't know what it is, and I don't have any data, but it was amazing that he won, wasn't it? So,
well, I think that we're amazed, A, that he won. Right? But he didn't, he didn't just win. He won by the Electoral College, but he didn't win by the popular vote.
And the,
by $3 million.
The 3 million people.
Wasn't it down to just like 80,000 people in all four of the states that won?
64.
64,000 people in those states made him president.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Hillary just didn't, you know, go to those states. She didn't get her people out.
Yeah,
to vote.
But it's
I'm
just
sure she had the votes.
But you see, here's Trump's attitude: is that he feels that he needs, because he won, he should get the respect of everybody else.
Exactly.
That's automatic respect. Right. And I'm sorry, you have to. You still, whether you're president or not, you have to earn it. You know, in most cases, you've got maybe 3-6 months where people will give you a grace period to get used to the job. But in this case, he jumped in with both feet and fists flying. And
you're right, Phil. He did not get 3 hours. And that's because of 15 months of what he did.
Yeah, but he said that this is exactly what he was going to do on day one, and he said he was going to work hard and push his agenda, and that's what he's been doing.
But he lied because he hasn't done it.
Well, that's what he's attempting to do.
No, that's what he's attempting to do. But just because you sign an executive order doesn't mean that executive order holds. Just because you say, here's my budget, it doesn't mean that budget's going to get accepted. He's just going through the motions.
Guantanamo Bay, right?
What? Yeah.
Didn't Obama sign an executive order to close Guantanamo Bay?
I don't think he ever signed the executive order, but he said, from my first day in office, I'm going to close down Guantanamo. However, he got into office and somebody went, it's not that easy.
Obama found out there's a good golf course there, and he says, I can't close this.
No, I think what Obama found out is, you're going to move these people? Where are you going to put them?
You're going to do golf jokes?
Wouldn't you rather make Guantanamo livable rather than have these people be in like the Supermax or in local penitentiaries in various states around the United States? And the answer was, I'd rather, you know, practically, it was better to have them in Guantanamo.
But the problem was, if they moved them to the United States, they'd have to give them a trial, I think. Whereas when they're in Guantanamo, they can just leave.
Oh, my God, a trial?
Yeah.
What kind of barbarism is that?
Yeah. Well, a kangaroo court.
Well, I mean, there are a lot of people there who have not in any way had a trial.
Right. Yeah.
You know, to this day.
And, you know, in our Constitution, there's something about a speedy trial, and they're being denied that.
What are you talking about? There are different rules for American criminals and the rules aren't the same.
That's right. So once you bring them to the United States, don't they have to be, isn't there a different system that they're going to have to be dealt with? And that,
by the way,
a speedy trial?
Bree is trying to call. And that would put you all
pictured.
You don't have to leave, Phil.
It's only 15 minutes.
Anybody want to go?
I'm
sorry, Bree, but I can't take you because
there's all men.
I just hung up on what?
There's all men. Bree's
a guy.
It's all men. Well, Bree is not a guy too.
Oh, never mind. Bree is a woman.
Thinking of that porno star.
Bree, if you're listening, it's too close to the end of the show, and we have a full house. And if I put on another caller, then all these people no longer have video. They'll just have audio, and it throws the whole thing in array.
Well, see, so, how far you can do like 25 people, right?
Let me log off.
John,
Alex,
let's make an appointment
I'll
for
log
me to
off and we'll let, switch let, another time.
Let's make an appointment for you and I to talk by Skype, and I'll get you all set up so that your camera's working, okay?
Okay. Well, I think I know what the problem was. I see on my homepage, I should have made this a video call when I called originally.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Because I think it just called normally. There's now shows.
All right.
You know,
will you call? Video, will you please?
It means I have to. I hang up and then recall you.
Please, like, will you call? Will you call again? You know, I want to.
Definitely.
I want to have you
on
the show.
We'll do it during the week when you know. Okay. When there aren't 8,000 people trying to get on.
Thank you.
Tuesday or Wednesday or something?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Tuesday or Wednesday.
Oh, yeah. Lots of stuff I'd love to talk to you about.
Okay, great. Thanks, John.
You know, I mean, politics notwithstanding. I like that, too. But still, I'll just listen to you guys this time. Take care, guys.
Bye-bye. Bye. Okay, let me see if I can go get Bree in Dubai. Let me see here.
He's around my age.
No, he's not picking up. He's not picking up.
Yeah, he's about your age, Brian.
Bree, if you're listening, Bree, give us a call, would you? Give us a call because we just got. Oh, there we go. No, there's John Rockwell. Oh, he's calling. He says add to group. And John, you're there again. John? Huh?
He might be messing with his Skype.
Could be. Could be. Anyway. I tried to call Bree, but unfortunately, it's not working. Let's see here. Let me try it again. No, it's not working. Oh well. Anyway, let me try one more time here. Oh, there we go. There we go. Add to group, and let me go here. Hello, Bree.
Back to a full house.
Are you there, Bree?
Microphone,
Bree. Are you there, Bree?
Picture.
Well,
he just lost.
He just dropped. Well, we didn't have any problems tonight with Skype, except just now. So, you know, but anyway, where was I? Let me see here. There was one other thing that was happening. The Republicans don't want to hold hearings on Russia. Did you hear about that one? Huh?
Is that a surprise?
Yeah. Shocker. Well, it's not a surprise, but it's a bad deal, you know?
Hey, there's one other thing in the news that you might like.
What's that?
On a Republican thing. Hardcore porn was blasted on a public speaker system in the middle of the night in a Turkish city. So porno was being played. Now, they took your idea of playing porn on GabNet. Porn audio, and they did it in Turkey.
Well, I wanted to do it. I wouldn't do it now, I think, because of our new carrier here. I don't know what their sensitivities are. The people in the Netherlands didn't give a shit what you did on your shows. I think they have a no porn rule or something. But anyway, Bree, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
There he is. But anyway, my idea was to just play the soundtrack from porno films overnight and see how much of an audience we got, which I imagine would be huge, okay? Because by 1 o'clock, somebody would be calling somebody else and say, have you heard this? You know, and before you know it, it'd become like viral. How you doing, Bree? What's happening in Dubai?
Good. Well, you know, it's harder to join now because you're an hour earlier because of the
seven
time change.
So you don't do the daylight savings time thing there.
That's right.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay. Used to call it was 8. Now it's what, 7?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I one of the reasons I didn't pick up the phone originally is because
I heard.
We have a full house here, and now when we got rid of somebody, you know, you're here. It's fine, working fine.
Yeah. Well, Alex, there was something that's been bothering me the last couple of days, and I was hoping I could get in, and I don't know if you've made mention of it, but the electronics ban out of Dubai. This is really, really, incredibly, unbelievably stupid.
Wait a minute. Electronics ban
on airplanes
out of Dubai as well.
Anything
it affects
larger than a smartphone, right?
Certain airlines, I think. It's not just countries.
You're talking about airplanes.
Emirates and
that's right.
Yeah, it's airlines and designated countries.
Any flight that touches Middle Eastern airports.
Yeah, so but this is just a British thing, right?
Oh, no.
It's American.
Thing.
So, in other words, let's say you're coming from Dubai. You can't bring your cell phone.
Let him
answer. He's in Dubai. Yes.
I can bring. Well, see, that's the problem. I don't know what I can and cannot bring because they don't have specific details. They refuse to give them. The White House has been asked many times what qualifies as a cell phone, and they say, hey guys, you know, there's sort of universal understanding about what that is. And, well, no, there isn't. If I have a Lenovo Fab, apparently, you know, that's a cell phone, but I hear it may or may not be acceptable. And the other thing is they want to put the electronics in the cargo hold. Yeah. Now, this is ridiculous. There's another rule that says you can't put lithium-ion batteries in a cargo hold.
Exactly.
Just goes on and on. Yeah, Abu Dhabi. We have greater security at Abu Dhabi than 99% of the airports in the United States itself.
Wow.
Abu Dhabi is a U.S. border city, meaning when you go to Abu Dhabi in the United Arab Emirates and you check in, you are officially in the United States of America. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's unbelievable what they're doing.
Okay, so let me ask you this question, Bree. Let's say you're coming to New York, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And you have a cell phone. Can you bring that cell phone on the plane, or what do you have to do with it in order to get that cell phone to New York?
Well, I guess FedEx it to myself when I arrive.
I heard that cell phones, they said now, are okay, but other types of things aren't. But then they said if you have a cell phone in the plane, you can activate something in your luggage that's in the cargo hold with the cell phone. But the reason for this was that the intelligence said that they had a credible threat. And this intelligence was gathered during the Yemen raid. So
no, they didn't. That's also inaccurate. It was another thing that was thrown out there. And the other thing is there are cells all over the world.
Well, you say it's inaccurate. What do you mean by it's inaccurate? It's just not true.
It's not true.
Well, I guess they wanted to.
You mean the people you call fake news, Phil?
No, CNN and CBS.
Yeah, those are the people. Those are the people you call fake news.
Yeah, but that's what they reported, that there was a credible threat.
So they're not fake news anymore?
Well, yeah, they're fake news when it comes to Trump, but they reported a credible threat.
Let Bree continue with what he was saying.
It wasn't essentially. What it is the airlines here are so much better to fly. I mean, it used to be historically we would have a couple choices flying out. You'd fly Emirates, or you could fly United, or you'd fly Delta. Mm-hmm. Now, my employer usually, you know, picks for me, but I would tell them, hey, look, I'll fly Emirates and I'll pay the difference because I want to fly Emirates. I don't want to fly United and Delta. And the reason why is quite obvious, and that is service and quality and just a pleasant experience, mm-hmm. you know, versus a nightmare. So basically, Delta and United no longer fly out of here, and basically the Middle East airlines are eating their lunch, and this was a way to get back at them and to say, well, we can cut into their business travelers because they won't be able to use their laptops. So instead, let's have them put the laptops in the cargo hold, which is extremely dangerous. And so we could get two things happening at once. One is we can injure economically mm-hmm. these airlines, and two, we could maybe cause a fire in the cargo hold, and that will also be negative for
Rob.
Them.
Rob has his hand raised. Yes,
yeah.
Rob.
I just to address the difference in the airlines, because I know it too. When I fly, I've flown Japan Air, I've flown Korean Air, I've flown Singapore Air. All a much better experience than you get from the U.S. airlines, and at better prices. However, the big the big disadvantage for the American airlines is that those airlines are all subsidized by their governments.
So nope, there's another. Sorry to interrupt you. That's also fake news. You know,
I have a list of the countries.
First of all, who makes airplanes and where are they based? And then who buys them? Okay, that's number one. So the United States government sends delegations to foreign countries in order to get them to buy what kind of aircraft? Boeing. Where's Boeing? Okay, that's number one. You don't think that the U.S. government has given subsidies to Boeing? They have.
Not only do they airlines themselves. I'm not talking.
They do that too. Historically, look at the airlines in the United States. They all receive some kind of subsidy. They just don't receive a lot. The other thing is,
any of those airlines, Bree, are owned by the government. French owns Air France. The Swiss Air is owned by Switzerland.
Yeah. So what's the point you're trying to make, Phil?
What kind of subsidy do they need when they're actually owned by the government and they're subsidizing the whole thing? That's what I was refuting, that they weren't getting subsidies.
Phil, you of all people, I'm really surprised to hear you saying this is the marketplace. So you're saying that somebody has an unfair advantage, and then you're saying because they have better quality and service that they that we should subsidize the U.S.?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying it's an unfair advantage.
It's not. Okay, first of all, I'm telling you that is not true. Every airline has been subsidized in the U.S. We don't have enough time to get into it. Yeah. I can send you the links. But just look that up. That has been refuted. It's been disputed. And the other thing is we also did the same thing with our airlines. And they're flying the Boeing aircraft. So, yeah.
Dubai is in the United Arab Emirates?
Right.
Okay, so that's one of the countries where Jordan, Egypt, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Qatar, Kuwait, and the United Arab Emirates none of them are covered by the Trump administration ban on travel, but they are mostly Muslim nations. So these are the nations that if you're traveling with electronic equipment, but it says that you could have a cell phone, but anything larger than a cell phone has to be stowed in the
But my cell phone is a Lenovo Fab, which doesn't count. It's apparently too large.
Hey, listen,
even though it is a cell phone,
there's our theme. Thanks for calling, Bree. You really took a got the last part of our show to be meaningful, you know. I mean, it really and take us on an entirely different subject, which is terrific. Thank you, Bree. I really appreciate it. I'm glad you were able to finally get through. I also want to thank Scott. He's our anchor person here. Dan, thank you. Always love seeing you. Kevin, you're great. Rob, you know you're the best. Bob Eberth, we love having you on here. Phil Meyer. Jeff Stein. Are you still there, Jeff?
I'm quasi here.
Yeah, you don't have your camera on. What do you mean? You're quasi there?
The camera's not working.
Oh, okay. Well, that's all right. I see your lovely mug in the photograph. And Brian, thank you for calling too. Another full house tonight. Four nights in a row, a full house.
Wow.
What is happening to this program? I don't know. I sound like Jerry Seinfeld. Thank you, everybody. I appreciate it. Okay, and thanks to.
Thanks, Alex.
Let me see here. Let me change my thing here. There we go. Here's me. I want to say goodbye to everybody. I'm going to hang up on them, so the next show can use the phones. It's like somebody standing in a hallway waiting to use the phone. Anyway, to all of you out there, thank you so much for joining us on the Ramble. As I say, another wonderful night of people, of a full house. And stay tuned now for Jack and Amy. They're next with The Intersection, followed at 1 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time with Connections. In the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her, okay?